I don't think these are.
Good morning. I'm Caitlin Arsenal.
I'm Alexandria Reina Letty.
And I'm Jasmine Ferrante.
For our senior projects, we did Alice, an active shooter training for K through 5. We did this by making a video that breaks down the steps for elementary kids to understand easier. We decided to teach kids because when we learned Alice, we knew it would be complicated without a video or a visual aid. One statement that I learned when I was doing my research that we used in our videos is, this is not to scare you, this is to prepare you. Oops. Our initial goals was to make a video for the help K through 5 understand Alice, us understanding Alice and why it's better than Code Red now, having meetings with Officer McManus weekly, and trying to get a meeting with the safety committee and health and safety of RSU 5.
Now, what exactly is Alice training? Alice training is an advanced and strategic method used in active shooter situations. This technique was created in the year 2000 and has been taught in various organizations, businesses, and schools. Alice stands for Alert, Lockdown, Inform, Counter, and Evacuate. Evacuating the building is always the main goal of Alice. This method is on the rise across the United States. According to CNN, 5,548 school districts are fully trained in Alice.
When comparing Alice to a Code Red, Alice training. This training helps evacuate the school when there's an intruder in the building. Alice training helps prepare students and teachers to defend themselves if they were in the presence of a violent intruder. An example can be throwing things at the intruder, like books, water bottles, or other objects you can find around the classroom. Throwing things at the intruder can help distract them and they could possibly drop their weapon. This training also teaches students and teachers how to lock down the classroom if evacuation is not possible. Locking down the classroom, you can use chairs, desks, and piling them up against the door to create a barricade. On to a Code Red. A Code Red is where you're sheltered in place in case of a violent intruder. Sheltered in place means that the teachers are supposed to gather the students and any near them in the hallway. When the Code Red occurs, the teachers will then secure the students in the classroom away from the door. The teachers will then lock the door and turn off the lights. Mr. Stivers, an administrator at Region 10 in Brunswick, went from using Code Reds to using Alice training. I interviewed him to see which one he preferred. He said, I favor Alice over a traditional Code Red because it allows flexibility and options for those in the line of fire.
So why we chose Alice is our junior year at Region 10, we learned about Alice training for active shooter. We thought it was a great idea and we wonder why it was not at our school.
We strongly believe that this is a better method of a lockdown. The main reason we think this is because there is an evacuation process, whereas with a Code Red, there is no formal evacuation process.
When thinking about our senior project ideas, we definitely wanted to make a change. We right away thought about the safety of our school and thought about Alice training and how it could be helpful at RSU 5. In the last 10 years, there was 180 school shootings with 356 victims. These stats are from CNN News. We wanted kids at RSU 5 to be prepared for this situation if this were to happen with increasing numbers of school shootings.
We also wanted to help out Officer McManus. When explaining to him that we wanted to make a video about Alice for our senior project, he thought it was a really good idea. There were some uncertainties about who our target audience would be, but then after some brainstorming, we came up with making a video for K through 5. We decided to make an Alice training video for kids so they'll understand better what this training is. This will help out Officer McManus in the future if they decide to switch to Alice training.
Freeport High School skills that we used. The three of us all took public speaking and yearbook. These classes were really beneficial because we learned how to communicate and edit, as well as interview our fellow peers. Time management and reliability were significant skills we all individually improved on. We had the responsibility to reach out to RSU 5 administration and plan weekly meetings and attend them on time. We also had to advocate for ourselves when we had questions or needed help. Time management was another big skill because we all had work and sports to manage and we did not want to overlap meetings or events. Another skill that came into play was taking advantage of social media. I am Freeport's senior class historian in student government, and one of my duties is to promote the school's fundraisers and events. We wanted to create an Instagram account about Alice training to inform others who may want to learn more information.
Some takeaways that we had from our senior project were there was a lot of different perspectives and opinions about our project and our video and how we should go about our project. We took people's advice and what we would like to see our project do, and Officer McManus's guidelines to make our project what it is today. We became really good at scheduling because we had a packed schedule and a really big to-do list, and we had to work around quarantine, sports, APs, works, and student government. Our communication skills was a huge takeaway. It was important to make sure everybody was on the same page as us. We had to communicate with Mr. Dierberg, Mass Landing, parents, safety committee, Officer McManus, and many others.
Now, the students' perspectives. It was very important for us to hear our student body's thoughts on lockdowns at the high school level. Therefore, we made a survey and sent it out to grades 9 through 12. Out of the responses we received, 57% of students have not heard of Alice in the past. The majority of students expressed to us that they want to improve our current Code Red method. Here are some comments that were left on our survey. I feel like there could be a better and safer way. I think Alice would be much more effective for students in high school. It's not the best because we just sit in the corner and not even hidden if someone was to come into the school. This information tells us that students are on board with improving our lockdown method. Safety is a top priority, and we believe that students should feel confident and safe in school no matter what the situation is.
On to our challenges and successes. Our first challenge, I had to quarantine for the first week of our project, which meant I was not allowed on any school grounds, so we could not film our video in the first week. Our second challenge was Jasmine ended up having some AP classes the first week and then her AP exam the second week, so she was studying a lot. And then she also took an ASL class, so she was attending classes, and Katie had softball practice. So she had to work around both of our busy schedules. And then we had to make a second video for the safety committee because we had to say like why we wanted to do this for our project. We planned on meeting them like in person, but since they haven't had a meeting since January 2020 due to COVID, it was hard to make a meeting. Our fourth challenge was that we couldn't send our 6-minute video to Officer McManus or the safety committee, but with help from Mr. Picard, it was successful. And then we were unable to use a prop weapon in our video, so it was hard to make the intruder look like the intruder. On to our successes. We ended up making both of our videos on time for our deadline and then the safety committee's deadline. We sent out our Google form, and we were unsure if students would respond to that, but we got 35 responses. And we did end up making our weekly meetings with Officer McManus and Mr. Dierberg. And our final success is we equally divided our work, like our research, making this presentation, and filming our video.
So we have a clip from our video that like we just did A through E. So we're just gonna show you the clip that we
have. A is for alert. If you hear someone over the loudspeaker saying there is an intruder in the building, then your teacher will tell you what to do next and how to be prepared.
So readers, can you just look over here for me? I just want to talk to you about a little bit about what you need.
Please excuse the interruption. There is an intruder in the main lobby. Please excuse the interruption. There's an intruder in the main lobby. Please listen to your teachers for your next steps.
So boys and girls, we're going for lockdown. Voices off, all the way in.
Eyes for inform. You will hear over the speaker of updates that are happening with the intruder in the building, such as the intruder is located by the main office area.
Girls, I want you to look up here. We're going to just talk about reading for a second.
Please excuse the interruption. There is an intruder in the main office area. There is an intruder in the main office area. Please listen to your teacher for next step directions.
E is for evacuate. Once you know it's safe, your teacher or police officers will help you get out of the building or relocate.
So eyes on me, because they're on the other end of the building, I need you to follow me. We're going to evacuate out the door. Please, the last person in line, close the door behind you.
Next, you will have a designated spot where you exit the building. You will want to follow your teacher out the doorway that is closest to your classroom.
L is for lockdown. If you can't evacuate, then your teacher will lock down your room. You will see your teacher grabbing chairs and desks to block the door, to create a barrier between you and the intruder.
So boys and girls, can I have your eyes up here? I want to talk about what's going
Please
on.
Please excuse the interruption. There is an intruder in the fifth grade wing. Please excuse the interruption. There's an intruder in the fifth grade wing. Please listen to your teacher for next steps.
Boys and girls, come right into lockdown. I need you to stay over here. I'm going to go close the door. Please stay safe and quiet.
Since this classroom is located in the fifth grade wing, you will see the teacher blocking the doors to make a barricade. C is for counter. Counter is the last resort step in Alice. The main goal is to distract the intruder, and you can do this by throwing nearby objects, such as water bottles or books. This is not to hurt the intruder, just to get them out of the mindset of hurting others. You can also yell to create noise and help distract the intruder. A is for alert. If you hear someone over the loud.
Big thank yous to Mr. Dierberg, Officer McManus, the RC5 Safety Committee, and Freeport High School.
Superintendent Foley, Principal Grogan, Principal Grimm, and Mrs. Zakow.
Mr. Picard, Mr. Stivers, our Mass Landing School volunteers, and our parents.
Final questions.
Yes.
Did the kids seem scared at all when you were doing these demo videos?
So the question was, did the kids, when we made our videos, were scared when, with the rest of the
When we filmed the video.
When we filmed the video. The kids were not scared. We did, explained what we were doing, and then we used the, saying that this is not to scare you, this is to prepare you. They had a good time doing it. They're not scared at all. Any other questions?
Yes, Mr. G.
At what point in the process of adopting this or considering this for RSU5 did you kind of reach with the committee?
Okay. So the question was, at one point when we decided to do this video, did we reach out to the committee? And I think it was after we met with Officer McManus was when we decided, and he's like, let's bring this up to the safety committee and we can talk about it for the future.
Any other questions? Yes, Mr. Dierberg?
Yeah, after you met with the safety committee, did they give you any feedback?
So the question was, after we met with the committee, did they give us any feedback? We did send out a Google form to the safety committee and we got comments back. Mostly just some slight changes with wording. They were on board with the idea, and they wanted more information about it, and we definitely plan to continue talking with them.
Any other questions?
still have like a minute to take your time.
It's okay.
Hello, my name is Julian.
Nick.
Cam.
And welcome to our project, Solar Future.
So as we started with our project, we asked ourselves this question. How can we create a guide to educate, convince, and help the people of Maine to make the change to solar energy?
So for the goals of this project, we want to learn the ins and outs of solar energy. We want to meet solar experts and customers in the field. And we also want to find a way to effectively present our findings. We initially thought a pamphlet or a booklet would do the trick, but then we decided on a website, and that was going to be our best option. But we didn't want to create a generic website from a template. We wanted to create our own from scratch, so we had to learn the code necessary to do so.
So we split our project up into three separate parts. The first part was basically the research that went into the project. And the research is the research that we did in the first part is kind of what the whole pretty much all the content on the website is. And we did most of the research through websites and videos, and this is what we learned. So solar energy is the process that converts sunlight into usable electricity and renewable energy. And it's done through a process called the photovoltaic effect that basically takes the photons from the sunlight and through the two layers of photovoltaic material in the solar panels, it's usually silicon, converts it into electricity that can be used. Now, there are a lot of policies in Maine that make solar energy much more attractive. One example is net metering, which directly reduces the price of your electricity bill based on how much solar power you generate. Another example is PACE loans, which makes solar panels more affordable for homeowners in Maine. And an alternative to rooftop solar is called community solar. In the top right, there's a community solar farm. And what you do is you buy a portion of that farm in either a subscription or a share. A subscription would be like a month-to-month rental sort of thing. And a share is like a straight-up purchase. And you get the energy that that portion generates. You can use that to both your electricity bill and your energy. And there are many benefits to going solar, but I think the most obvious ones and most important ones are that it reduces your carbon footprint and helps you save money in the long run.
So part two of our process was communications and outreach. And basically, we wanted to expand on the knowledge that we built through our research by talking to a lot of professionals and businesses that have solar energy. So we did this by talking to Revision Energy, Maine Beer Company, Wilbur's of Maine, Freeport Inn, Falmouth Public Schools, and Buck's Naked Barbecue. So we started by talking to Vaughn Woodruff, who is a training director at Revision Energy. He previously owned InSource Renewables, who is currently helping Freeport High School with their ongoing solar project. Vaughn gave us a lot of specific information on like rules and incentives on solar in Maine. And he also showed us some graphs and data that his company uses. So over there on the bottom right is an example of like a chart that his company uses. So he'll show that to like his incoming customers to decide like what avenue of solar to take. We then met with John Gagne from Maine Beer Company. He gave us a super in-depth tour. We went up on the roof and he showed us all around their solar energy setup. He gave us some specific information on what something like that would cost. They have over 500 solar panels, so it's like a really large scale application. And he also gave us some of the pros and cons that they've found. And then on the top right and the bottom left are a couple pictures of their solar inverters. So basically what that does is it takes the DC electricity that their panels generate and then it converts it back into AC electricity, which can go back into the grid.
For the coding portion of this project, first we need to learn how to code. I read a book on HTML and CSS, and Julian also watched some YouTube videos and surfed the web to learn how to code these two languages. And then we typed out all the website content on some Google Docs, so each page served as the five website pages. And then after that, we coded all of that information into the website on a notepad document. And from there, we bought a server to host our website, and we also bought a domain on godaddy.com for solarfuture, me.com. So what is HTML? HTML is the backbone of almost every website on the web, like Amazon.com, Google.com, pretty much any website you can name. It consists of many tags in which you can insert information, like pictures, videos, text, links. It stands for Hypertext Markup Language. And for our website, this was mostly text, images, and some links. And these are all the pages on our website, so this is just the backbone. So what is CSS? CSS is cascading styling sheets. So it works by styling every HTML element. So without the CSS, the HTML looks pretty ugly. So the CSS styles the positioning of the pictures, the colors, the background, the border. So that's what it pretty much functions on our website. And this is part of a CSS page on our website.
So through the three processes, the research, the communications and outreach, and finally the creation and the coding and culmination of the whole website, we created our website, and this is the top of the homepage, and you can check out the whole thing at solarfutureme.com after this is all over. It is not yet optimized for mobile, but it looks better on a computer. But yeah, that's our website.
So our project gives back to the community in a couple of ways. The first one being we're giving our website to Ms. Hunter for her use in her AP Environmental Science class. So she's going to be able to go in there and pull whatever sort of information she'd like to help her teach her lessons on renewables. And then it's also, since it's a solar specific to Maine website, it's going to be available to our community so they can go in there and learn about solar in Maine.
So for the skills gained, we gained a strong knowledge on solar energy and the process of converting to solar energy. We also learned how to approach and act professionally and reach out to professionals in the field, and this is going to help us in the future when we have to do so to get jobs and whatnot. And we also developed some coding skills that will take us, you know, in whichever endeavor we decide to choose.
So we also used a lot of skills that we learned at Freeport High School. The first one, Cam and Nick both took a environmental science class at Freeport High School. It's an AP class taught here, and in that class they were able to pretty much get a good understanding of renewable energy in general, and specifically solar energy, definitely. And from there, it definitely helped us with our first 2 weeks, and just kind of getting a head start on pretty much everything there is to know about solar. And that kind of brings us into the second skill that we use, which is research. In almost every class at Freeport High School, we do a lot of research. We're expected to do research at a high level, and that definitely translated to our project and being able to do research effectively and efficiently. On the website, on the fourth page, it's all about the cost of solar energy. It talks about, you know, everything there is to do with inverters, the panels themselves, the installation, the cost of that, solar batteries, and how that all changes the price. And that page is filled with math, and I think the math that we learned at Freeport High School definitely helped us to complete that page.
So there are a number of aspects of our project that went pretty well. The first one being our research. We had a number of productive research sessions where we learned a lot about renewable energy, and we were able to build on that knowledge by meeting with businesses and experts, so we thought that was a really good experience. And then our website development overall went pretty smoothly.
For the challenges of this project, our original idea was to put a plan in place to put solar panels on the roof of the high school, but that didn't go quite as planned, as the RC5 is already underway with a community solar project in Acton, Maine. So it's definitely a positive for Freeport and the RC5, but we definitely had to pivot our project from there and, you know, decide a new route. We didn't get enough responses from the people we contacted. We got a lot of them back, but we definitely would have liked to talk to more people, but we definitely made do. And also another challenge was just the tedious process of coding. We had to go back through our code many times to fix problems, center everything on the page, find the right border, and, you know, there was definitely numerous 10-hour days we put in as well. We want to thank Jonathan Gagne from Maine Beer Company. He gave us a great tour. We got to go on the roof. We understood so much more after the tour of Maine Beer, and, you know, it was just a great experience overall.
We also want to thank Vaughn Woodruff from Revision Energy. He showed us a lot of the charts and graphs that his company uses, as well as just teaching us a lot about the ins and outs of solar in Maine.
We'd like to thank Andy Wilbur from Wilbur's in Maine and every other small company that in business that we contacted that talked to us about their solar adventure.
We want to thank Dee Dee Bunnell for helping us with the research and just preparing for our project before it even started. She helped us get contacts and just people to reach out to, and that set us in the right direction.
Thank you to Ms. Hunter for being our project advisor.
Thank you to Mr. Willett and Dr. Foley for basically rejecting our initial plan and kind of helping us get a new project going.
Ms. Levitt, Ms. Peterson for helping us craft our proposal before it even started as well, and, you know, we got into a great direction as well.
And thank you to FHS for this opportunity.
Ms. Levitt.
Questions? The question was, did any of us know about coding before this project, and if not, how do we teach ourselves? I did, so there's a bunch of computer science language, and I knew like two of them, but none of them that we ended up using for websites. I knew Python and some Java, but I did not know any HTML or any of that.
I didn't really know much coding before, but thankfully the languages we learned weren't like too robust, and they're pretty easy to learn. So yeah. It's not like a flashy website, it's kind of like an informational website. So yeah, it wasn't too difficult to learn the languages.
Yeah, it took us a lot of time.
Yeah, it definitely took us a lot of time.
Yeah, Ms. Peterson?
How did the three of you decide on this project?
So the question was, how did the three of us decide on this project? And to be honest, I think one of us we knew we wanted to do a senior project together, but I think one of us just kind of threw out the idea of like solar panels as a joke, and then we were kind of like, wait a minute, that would be kind of a cool idea.
Yeah.
So. Yeah.
And then, you know, from our initial plan, I think we were just sitting on the couch in one of my rooms, and I think we just decided maybe a website would be a good idea. And we did it.
Ms. Golko? The question was, how does solar impact the finance of the companies like Wilbur's and Maine Beer? And those two companies they use a very different amount of energy. Wilbur's uses a lot less. They even use less than like a normal home. and Wilbur's, it costed them, I think, around $15,000. It was like 7 years ago when they started, so it was around $15,000, and they said they planned on making all of their money back in 10 years, which is less than main beer company, probably because they use a lot more energy, and for them, they got a lot of help from like grants and tax credits, but they spent closer to $300,000, and it's going to take them around 200 months to make all their money back. But solar panels have a lifespan of around 30 years, so they're definitely making a lot of money in the long run.
And they're using a lot of energy, like a lot of energy. So it covers like 50% of their energy usage, which is quite a bit for how much equipment is going on. Oh, yes.
Coach. Hey, awesome job, obviously.
Thank you.
The question was, we talked a lot about like the pros and what cons they mentioned. It's actually kind of ironic because at least for Maine Beer Company, they didn't really have any cons. I mean, I guess the only really obvious con is like the initial like high cost of solar panels. But other than that, they were pretty confident that they're going to make back the money that they spent on it. So they didn't really have any, to be honest.
Yeah, and if it's done right, there isn't any cons. You can combat by doing research and by just knowing more about what you're doing.
All right, thank you. when you're ready.
All right. Hi, my name is Meredith, and welcome to my project, Back to the Earth. It's a glimpse of what goes into a farm. So before I begin, I'd like to give some context. I chose this project because I've always had this dream of one day when I'm older, settling down on a large plot of land and just being self-sustaining and living a simple life. I'd like to know where my food is coming from and what goes into the growing process of it. And I'd like to eventually reduce my carbon footprint as much as possible. Now with that said, going into my project and writing my proposal, I was really ambitious and I had a lot of ideas of what I wanted to do. And I was talking with Mr. Birkemeyer and I wanted to understand what it takes to have and to start my own farm and garden. I wanted to have planted at least 5 vegetables or any type of produce. We had the idea of clearing land for some berry patches and planting them, and a lot of high expectations like planning or building an irrigation system for watering. But when I started the project, I realized a month isn't really a long time for the kind of goals I had, and I needed to adjust and tweak them. I still wanted to have an understanding of what it took to start and have my own garden, but I realized I needed to lower my goals a little bit and narrow them down to learning more about soil and seedlings and the plants themselves, not necessarily give myself an exact number of vegetables to grow and plant. I wanted to master the tractor and learn how to drive and operate it, and I wanted to gain confidence on how to grow my own produce. So at the beginning of the project, I realized arguably the most important part of planting is the soil, because it's the foothold for roots and it's what gives the plants the nutrients in order to grow. So I realized I'm going to need to learn about this. I'm going to need to know what the pH and the composition of the soil that we'll be working with is. So I did some research and I learned about soil testing. And it's actually something you can do at home. It's cheap and it's an all-natural way. To test for composition, which is like the build and the makeup of the soil, what I had to do was I had to go to Goodwill and I bought some mason jars that were clear and large enough for me to use. I went around the farm and I gathered 4 different soil samples from 4 different locations, and what I did was I put the soil in the mason jars and I used warm water and soap and I stirred it and I let the soil samples sit on my deck for at least 4 days, and my mom wasn't too happy about this. It wasn't exactly a pretty sight, but it worked. I got to see the composition and the build of the soil, and it's kind of clear. You can see that there's different layers. At the top, there's a lot of sand, and at the bottom, there's a lot of clay that sinks. And when you're planting, you need a certain type of soil. You need what's ideal is loam, which is in balance between sand, silt, and clay. But what the farm had was a lot of clay-dense composition, and we were going to have to outsource for our soil because clay is not great for drainage when there's too much of it. So the roots would end up drowning or we'd get root rot. So thankfully, Mr. Birkemeyer has students and friends who give him their lawn clippings and their leaves and their extra dirt and soil. So we were able to use this, and it's composed of a bunch of nutrients as the leaves and grass decompose, so it's like planting gold. After I learned about soil, it was time to learn about what I was going to actually plant, which was seedlings. And Mrs. Birkemeyer has been working on her seedlings for months. It's something I learned you have to do months in advance and prepare for planting. And these are her cooler season sampling or seedlings. They're onions, broccoli, cabbage, and some cauliflower. And they do better usually before Memorial Day when the season is still cooler. But this year it was starting to get warmer, so we were able to plant it before Memorial Day. I learned about germination period and how much time and maintenance actually goes into preparing to plant things. Mrs. Birkemeyer would spend hours in the morning just going around her house and rotating the plants so that each and every one got enough water and sunlight. It's very tedious, but it's a rewarding process. I also learned that seedlings will actually tell you when they're ready to be planted. There's the first leaves that come off the stomata that are called the cotyledon leaves, and they're the small ones, but after the cotyledon leaves are the true leaves, which tell you that these seedlings are ready to be planted. They're ready for soil hardening, and they're ready to grow in the ground. So after I learned about seedlings, it was time for me to actually get my hands dirty, go to the farm, and use the tractor. And honestly, this is my most favorite part of my project. Bert gave me a little bit of a crash course and then let me do my own thing. And I was nervous at first, but after a few runs, just driving up and down the farm, I realized it's like driving. You got forward, reverse, and then you just have your gears to control the control and operate the bucket. So I used the tractor for a bunch of different tasks, but mainly I used it to spread wood chips around the garden paths. So on the picture on the left, this is the garden before I put wood chips down, and we put them down to control the weeds and to keep them from growing and to keep the paths clear. And on the right, you can see that after days of hard work and labor and sweat, I finally finished putting down the wood chips. And I was so proud of myself. I felt great. I was like, okay, we can actually start planting now and weeding and doing all of that. But not even 3 days later, our first setback happened. All of the weeds had grown through the wood chips, literally everywhere. I was really discouraged and I felt defeated. But I had to get rid of that defeated mindset, and I just thought to myself, what can I do to fix this? And I remembered that when I was little, my dad and I used to work out in the yard together, and we had a bunch of weeds, and my dad would kill them by using an all-natural solution with vinegar and just a pump sprayer that you can get from Home Depot for like 15 bucks. It's so cheap. Vinegar is like $2 a gallon. It's all-natural, and it's effective, so I figured, you know, why not try it? So I asked the Birkemeyers for their permission, and I tried it, and we did small patches in the garden to see if it would work, and it actually did. But we had to move on with our project, so I only could do small patches at a time, so I'll be going back to finish doing that. But that was my solution for it. So before you can plant, you actually have to prepare the garden beds. I was able to actually go through and de-weed about four or five of them on my own. As you can see, two pictures on the left are before, and then two pictures on the right are after. And Mrs. Birkemeyer taught me that if you actually use the shovel to dig the roots up from the weeds, you're killing two birds with one stone. You're getting rid of the weeds, but you're also turning the soil, which is aerating it and getting it ready to plant. And when we were done with the weeds, we were able to kind of recycle them in a way. There's a compost bucket that we just put everything into, so eventually it'll be used for compost and fertilizer. So after weeding, I was able to actually get my hands in the dirt and get dirty, which was so much fun. So Mrs. Birkemeyer and I worked together, and we planted her onion seedlings. We were able to plant broccoli and cabbage and some cauliflower as well. And as you can see, all of the seedlings were in these red solo cups that had holes on the bottom, which is a great and not an expensive way to plant seedlings, so it saves money, and she can reuse these as well. And I was actually able to plant my own flowers to bring home because we were running out of time and I didn't have enough time to plant in my own planter box yet. So to fix that, I planted some flowers, and there are three different kinds, and they're growing in my yard right now. But like I mentioned, I was able to actually build my own planter box with Mrs. Birkemeyer, and she taught me that my planter box should be level all around. It shouldn't be higher in one area, lower in the other, because drainage will be different. So what we did was we spent, I think it was like 3 or 4 hours out in the garden. We dug around an old planter box and we put down cinder blocks, and I actually had to use a level to make sure that the bricks were, or the blocks were even with each other. And it took lots of practice and just like trial and error. But we finally did it, and we put some of the outsourced soil that we had on the farm inside, and we are getting ready to mulch it and fertilize it as well. So throughout my entire project, without even realizing it, I was making these active connections between what I was doing and what I had learned in AP Environmental Science class. I highly recommend each and every one of you take it. It's a great class. I realized that Mrs. Birkemeyer is doing herself a great favor by planting all these different kinds of vegetables and produce and keeping biodiversity high within her garden. I remembered learning about the soil triangle, which includes loam, it has silt, sand, and clay, which are all three components of composition of soil. I realized that by actively planting a garden and working on the farm, I was inevitably going to reduce my carbon footprint because I'd be learning about how to source my own food and not rely on the transportation of shipping from countries for produce and all of that. And I realized that literally everything in the ecosystem has a purpose, including insects and different kinds of weeds and plants. Everything works together for one ecosystem. So my reflection and skills gained. I realized that my time management skills really need to be worked on. I had a lot going on, but that wasn't an excuse, and I needed to remind myself all the time that my project comes before things and I needed to schedule my time around it. I really had to work on my communication skills with Mrs. Birkemeyer and Mr. Birkemeyer for timing of me going to the farm and what we'd be doing. And I had to organize my project really well. I realized that when I was at the farm, my work ethic was really high and I was determined to I wanted to stay busy, I wanted to get things done, and I wanted to be productive, and I had a lot of fun. When I was driving the tractor, I had to pause sometimes and tell myself not to panic, to just think about what I was doing if I forgot how to operate the bucket, which is a life skill I will be using in the future. And like I said, I had to learn how to juggle a job, sports, and a laborious project. There were times when I was just, my back hurt from the way I was bending with a shovel and just digging in the dirt. And I realized I might actually have a green thumb. In the past, I've had, little cactuses and stuff like that, which should be hard to kill, but I've managed to. But at the end of this project, it's not really the end for me. I loved working on the farm so much that I'm hoping Mrs. and Mr. Birkemeyer will have me back and let me work on it this summer so I can plant in my own box that we made, and I can help Burke continue with his ideas, like maybe the berry patch that I mentioned in the beginning. And for my thank yous, I'd like to thank FHS teachers and staff for kind of harnessing all my skills and teaching me everything that I was able to use in this project. I'd like to thank my coaches, Mrs. Curry and Ms. Wood, for being patient with me at practice when I complained about being tired. Mr. and Mrs. Birkemeyer for giving me the opportunity to work on their farm. Ms. Hunter for teaching me all the things I learned in APES and was able to use in my project. My project advisor, Mrs. Taylor, I couldn't have done it without you. You helped keep me sane. And Mrs. Levitt and Mrs. Peterson for organizing senior projects. Any questions? Ms. Peterson.
Was there an element to farming that was harder than you expected it to be?
So the question was there an element to farming that was harder than I expected it to be? And in all seriousness, operating and pushing a wheelbarrow full of wood chips, it's so hard because you, one wrong shift of your weight and it just falls and everything spills. And I did that so many times and had to go back and scoop everything and put it back in. And so, in all seriousness, just working the wheelbarrow. Ms. Blyer? So the question was, after doing this project and realizing how hard farming actually is, do I still want to continue my dream in the future of having a farm? The answer is yes. I actually really enjoy working outside and working with my hands, and I like to think that I have a pretty strong work ethic, and I feel accomplished after doing hard tasks like this. And I love the idea of just being self-sustaining and the simplicity of it, so I think I'm gonna continue that.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Joe Less, and this is my senior project, JL Guitar Amps. When I started this project, my inquiry question going into it was, how can I create a custom guitar amplifier brand with which I can make a profit as well as support a local music store? And my overall goal for the project was to build 3 guitar amps from scratch and have them for sale at Doobie's Music, which is a local music store here in Freeport, by the end of my project. But first, some background, because I didn't go into this having never built an amp before. This all really started at the beginning of my junior year when I was taking Miss Goodspeed's amazing advanced engineering class, and I needed to do something for my first project. And I decided to see if I could build a guitar amp. And this is what I came up with. The circuit is a circuit of a 1950s Fender amp, Fender tube amp called the Tweed Champ, because they used to cover their amps in tweed to make them look like luggage. But anyway, this is what I ended up building. Everything's made from scratch, including the little metal enclosure for the electronics called the chassis. And even though everything's a little rough around the edges, it did sound great, and it was pretty cool that I had built my own amp. Then, a year later, I was taking Miss Goodspeed's advanced engineering class again, not because I had failed the class, but just because it's a fun class. And I decided to build another amp, because why not? And I put a little bit more time and effort into this one. Still made everything from scratch, but the circuit was a little bit more complicated. Another old Fender tube circuit. And just after putting a lot more effort and time in, I was able to create a much better and professional looking product. And this is when I kind of realized, like, hey, I could probably sell these. Also, if you don't know what a tube amp is, it basically means that the electricity flowing through the amp is controlled by these little glass things called vacuum tubes. Old TVs and radios and stuff, and even old computers used to use them, but they're eventually phased out by modern, more efficient technology. But they're still relevant to guitar amps because, for complicated reasons, tube guitar amps just kind of sound better, which is definitely a generalization, but it's kind of true, and most high-end amps still use those glass vacuum tubes. So I decided I was gonna build a few amps for my senior project, but I needed to decide which amp I was gonna build because I wasn't gonna design my own circuit from scratch. And I settled on this. This is an original 1950s or early 60s Fender amp called the 5F2A Tweed Princeton. And it's just a solid amp, and I decided that's the one I was gonna make. So why did I choose this one? It's a very simple circuit, so I knew it would be not too difficult to build in a short period of time, and if I had to troubleshoot anything, it wouldn't be a big deal. Also, it's a really popular and classic amp that I knew would appeal to a lot of people. And I already had the previous experience with Fender circuits. Both of the other tube amps that I had made in the past were both Fender amps. Also, if you didn't know what tubes are, you can see right over there the little glass things hanging from the bottom of the chassis are the vacuum tubes. But before May came and senior projects officially started, there was a little bit of work that had to happen leading up to it. First thing was research. Building one of these does require quite a bit of research. Also, ordering parts. You can buy kits for amps like these because building guitar amps is actually kind of a hobby that people do. But I decided to source all the parts myself to make the amp a little bit more unique to me. And I also wired the entire first chassis over April break because I had all the parts sitting in my basement and I'm just the kind of person that couldn't resist wiring it up. I also had to talk to Tom Doobie from Doobie's Music about selling my work there. And I just kind of called Tom and I was like, hey, can I sell my stuff here? And I already knew him a little bit from just being a frequent customer and showing him my other work. And he's a great guy. And he was like, yeah, totally. Let me know what you need. So thanks, Tom. And after all that was out of the way, it was time to actually get started. So on the left there, or on the right, you can see the original Fender schematic for this amp, and on the left is the wiring diagram that I found online to kind of guide me throughout the process. And I started with a blank chassis that I bought. I think I mentioned it in the previous two amps that I built, the chassis, the metal enclosure, I made from scratch out of sheet metal, but I decided for this project it would make more sense to just buy one online because they're available. I knew it would give me a more professional product in the end and take way less time, so that's what I ended up doing. I forgot to take a picture of the chassis that I started with, so I just kind of found one online to show you what it looked like. But I got all my transformers, switches, volume knobs, inputs, stuff like that mounted on, and then I was able to start the preliminary wiring for the second two amps that I hadn't already built. So that's what some of the first wiring looks like in there. And after that was out of the way, I was able to start in the turret boards. Turret boards are just kind of the historical precursor to the more modern like circuit boards that you would see when you take apart a computer or something. But basically what this is they just cut out some fiberglass, drilled a bunch of holes, and staked in, or like pressed in, these little metal turrets that you can solder all the electrical components to. So I did that for the remaining two chassis and soldered all the stuff and wires, and then I was able to mount them into the chassis that I'd previously done the early wiring and stuff for. After that, I was able to do all the finishing, wiring, just all the random connections that needed to happen. And as you can see, the tubes aren't plugged into the tube sockets there, but obviously that needed to happen before I tested them. And there is a pretty extensive testing process for these. You can't really just plug it in and hope it doesn't blow up. You need to like do it in steps and measure voltages and all that stuff. So I got all that out of the way, made sure that all the amps were functioning safely and properly so that I could actually sell them without worrying about that being like a safety issue or somebody's amp breaking right after they buy it. So did that. Now I had three working actual amp units. And then it was time to start on the woodwork, so like building the speaker cabinets. And as one often does before starting a project like this, I designed a model on my computer, which you can see here. I used SketchUp. And so I got my design done, and then I was able to buy some wood to get started. So I was kind of disappointed to see and realize that lumber is ridiculously expensive right now, so that was kind of annoying to be building an amp right now, or three amps right now. Two 10-foot pine boards at Home Depot cost $76, which is like totally ridiculous, but it is what it is, I guess. And the first challenge after I got them all cut to size was doing the finger joints, which is what you see over there. It's called finger joints just because it looks like fingers being locked together. But it's not an easy joint to do, at least for the average Joe, I guess. And no pun intended, actually. But anyway, I needed to figure out how to do that. So I built this jig with a hand router. And a router is a tool that just spins a cutting bit really, really fast so you can make different types of cuts through wood. And that little red blur in the picture there is you can see the router bit coming up through the bottom board. I just mounted the router to the bottom there. And then I made a little sled that you can rest the pieces of pine on, just slide them through the bit, and it creates these perfect little half-inch notches. So I got all my boards notched and then glued all the cabinet frames together, and before sanding, this is what everything looked like. But it was at this point that I realized I had to move to 2 amps instead of 3 because I was running a little bit low on time and I just didn't think it was feasible for me to finish all 3 amps within the month of May. Also, I knew I could just finish the 3rd amp later. I'm probably gonna be finishing that one this month. So that's what I decided to do at this point. After that, I did some preliminary sanding. I got all the finger joints sanded down. It started looking pretty nice. I also had to put a little bit of a wood filler in some of the gaps that did kind of happen. But I think the finger joints came out pretty well. After that, I rounded off the finger joints, did some other stuff, like cutting out the cutouts for the chassis, drilling holes, mounting the handles, stuff like that. And pretty soon, the cabinet frames were ready for their polyurethane finish. You can also see that I did add some cleats that the speaker board and the back paneling can mount to. So I just hung the cabinets up from my basement ceiling and slapped some polyurethane on and called it good for those. And then I was able to start on the speaker boards. So gotta thank Nate Gidding for supplying the plywood for this. I found some really nice Baltic birch plywood in the engineering room, which is, like I said, ridiculously expensive right now. And Ms. Goodspeed was like, yeah, I think that's Nate. So I emailed Nate and he was like, do you need this? Or I was like, do you need this? And he was like, nope, use it. So thanks, Nate. But anyway, I cut those out, made 2 of those because, like I said, only 2 amps now. Cut them out, cut out holes for the speakers, wrapped them in some acoustic fabric for the grill cloth. Then I made the back paneling out of some more 1/4-inch plywood, sanded it, put some polyurethane on. And then I had all the pieces of the amp ready to just be bolted and screwed together. I had the working chassis, speaker board, back paneling, and the cabinet frames. So I was just a few bolts and screws away from being finished. And this is what they looked like when I was done. Pretty good. So I was pretty excited with how they came out. Even though the one I built in the fall is pretty nice, I think these are a little nicer. Definitely like the best amps I've ever built. So that was cool. Really excited with that. And here are a couple more shots of what they look like front and back. And as you can see, I have one right here, so I can give a little demo here. The only problem with doing a demo with this amp is that it's like a 5-watt amp that's mostly made for practice, home use, and recording, not for like playing in an auditorium. So I'm not sure how well everybody's gonna be able to hear it, or at least the clean sounds. The way tube amps generally go is they start out clean, like jazz, rhythm guitar kind of ish. once you turn them up, you get some like more rock tones out of them. So we'll see what happens, but I'll be able to give a little demo now and have Jacob mute my mic so that the feedback doesn't like freak out on us.
Should be a pick in my pocket somewhere.
Whoops. All right, volume warning here, but you kind of have to hear out sounds. I have to play some Joe Walsh because Joe Walsh was known to record with this amp. Kind of cool fact. I guess I'm unmuted now. There's a little demo. I'm probably not the most capable guitarist to be demoing this amp, but it is what it is. did my best. But anyway, so those are the finished amps. Only step now was to just bring them over to Doobie's, get them on the sales floor. Tom and I put them up for sale for $9.99, which might seem a little bit expensive for like a practice amp that's only 5 watts and only has tone and volume control, but parts are expensive and there's a lot of labor, and it's actually a pretty reasonable price for like a boutique custom amp. But yeah, so some skills gained from FHS that were helpful in the project. Definitely just random engineering skills from taking 4 years of engineering classes, utilizing the good old engineering design process. CAD modeling, definitely helpful, like you saw in my computer-aided design model of the cabinet before I made them. Also working with spreadsheets because spreadsheets were kind of helpful in keeping track of my parts costs and hours into each amp. Some final reflections. Guitar amps are definitely expensive to build. I originally budgeted $1,000 for 3 amps, which I thought would be plenty, but it ended up costing $1,500, which was definitely not part of the plan, but I'll still make a decent profit back, assuming all these sell, which I'm pretty confident that they will. They also take a lot of time, and I mean, I kind of knew this from building 2 other ones, but I was kind of reminded that 3 amps in a month is a little bit ambitious for just having one person do it. But they're also very rewarding. I really love this work. I definitely enjoyed all the work that went into these amps, and having the final product that just looks really good and sounds great, and being able to look at it at the end and being like, whoa, like I made that, is pretty cool. And I think I'll be building more amps in the future just for that aspect. And some thank yous, of course. My parents have been really supportive throughout all of my engineering endeavors since I was little. My parents also lended me $500 to help fund the project, so thank you for that. Tom Doobie of Doobie's Music for supporting me and letting me sell my work at his store and trusting that I'm selling a high quality product. Ms. Peterson and Ms. Levitt for all the work that you do with senior projects and making it possible, thank you. Ms. Goodspeed for being my amazing project advisor and engineering teacher for all 4 years of high school. And of course, thank you to FHS for this opportunity. All right, do we have time for questions? A couple? Any questions? Oh, Cam.
I was Oh. Oh, okay. Oh, it's your question. Okay, I get it.
So, what, two questions.
Yeah. Yeah, good question. So the questions were, am I going to continue to build amps in the future, and will it be hard to part with these? First question, I think I will continue to build amps. I don't know if I'm going to like be mass producing them to sell constantly, but I'm going to be building more amps for myself, I think. And also, like, if I know friends and people, like personal connections that are like, hey, can you build me this amp, then I think I'll do stuff like that. But considering going into college and working over the summer, I'm not going to have too much time. And for the question about how hard it will be to part with these, I definitely am feeling like, yeah, I don't really want to say goodbye to these, because these are probably like the best amps that I've made so far, and now I have to like watch them all go, which is a little bit tough, but I know it'll give me more motivation to build better ones in the future, so I guess there's that. But yeah, currently I'm using this because I only have one for sale, so there's that. Yeah.
Yay.
Oh, thank you.
Very clear steps.
Yeah, how did the demo sound?
Are mics on?
Yeah. Our project is called Our Guide to COVID-19. My name's Haley.
My name is Mia.
And my name is Eli.
For our project, we interviewed frontline workers about their experiences with COVID to try to spread awareness about the sacrifices they made and obstacles they overcame.
The goal of our project was to inform people about frontline workers' experience with COVID-19 through interviewing them about their jobs and how they've been affected. We wanted to give these people appreciation and take the time to learn about their careers and how these people work under any and all conditions. Eli and I are interested in healthcare careers, so this project was also to gain some personal knowledge.
To complete our project, we had a 4-week plan. The first week consisted of narrowing down which jobs we wanted to interview, researching them, and then reaching out to people in our community we knew that had the corresponding career we wanted to interview. Week 2 was creating the questions to ask our interviewees and conducting the interviews. Once we had all the information from the interviews, we spent week 3 creating an Instagram page where we could share all the information we gathered. And lastly, week 4 was spent promoting our Instagram page and different COVID relief methods and gathering what we could to donate and give back to our community.
For our interviews, we took a week to research different careers and COVID statistics to create suitable questions for the different jobs. We also wanted to hear if our peers had questions about COVID, so we sent out a Google form with some questions about different careers we were planning on including. On the left is the Google form that we sent out through our social media, and then the right is the questions that we created from the Google form and by ourselves.
When choosing the careers we wanted to interview, we thought about the jobs that continued to work when everything shut down last March. These people had no choice but to go into work. These were the people that had to work under any and all circumstances. And here are some examples of the jobs that we cover.
So for the interviews, we started by making a list of people that are considered frontline workers. Then we thought of who we could reach out to in our community who would like to be interviewed. From this process, we narrowed it down to very interesting careers and people. The people we ended up interviewing were Mrs. Galco, the principal at FHS, Dr. Tim Fox, an ER physician, Melissa Hager, a registered nurse, Lynette Silva, a registered nurse, Ellen Golding, the director of the maternity unit at Midcoast Hospital, Carlton Lewis, a psychotherapist, Wendy Lewis, a psychotherapist, Heather Zakow, an elementary teacher, Harrison Bowen, a grocery store cashier, Sydney Bradshaw, a rapid response nurse, Dr. Mark Christensen, a neurosurgeon, Elena Wagner, a pediatric nurse practitioner, Susan Arsenal, an elementary teacher, Dr. Andrew Sheep, an ER physician, Dr. Catherine Ozarski, a pediatrician, Jennifer Mao, a spine research fellow, and Officer Weed, a detective. We did in-person and remote interviews based on the interviewee's availability and comfort. In our interview, we had questions we wondered ourselves and ones asked by students. The interview process was very enlightening for us, and we came to have a much deeper respect for these people and their careers. Hearing their stories was very humbling, as their experience with COVID was very different than ours. Heather Zakow, a teacher at Mass Landing School, said she experienced families sending their children to school even though they were exposed to COVID, putting the staff and their families at risk along with other students. Lynette Silva, a nurse at Midcoast Hospital, shared with us that she had worked in the COVID tent since the beginning of the pandemic, even through the winter. She was exposed to sub-zero conditions day and night. She has not been able to return to her regular work to this day. Sydney Bradshaw, a rapid response nurse, was forced to work at a hotel where they take care of homeless COVID-positive patients. Sydney's only protection while being alone with these patients was a walkie-talkie. She was exposed to drug use, sexual activity, and COVID-positive patients. They have had patients who have overdosed whose bodies they have to find in the morning. Hearing these stories opened our minds and hearts to people who have had to weather the storm on the front lines of the pandemic.
Our Instagram page has updates about what we are doing in all of our interviews with a photo of the interviewee, and the caption has a summary of the interview. We find that this is a great way to have people learn about how different careers were affected, and we share their stories and their tips for high school students who are picking a career. We have information about donating to COVID relief for families and individuals in need, and we also have information about what we can do to give back to our community and places bigger than our community, like nationally. We decided to make an Instagram page so we could reach our age group and spread awareness. Not only is an Instagram page more interactive with posts and stories, it's more accessible than a website where people can follow us for updates.
To create the post, we would combine all information we gathered during our interview to make a summary of what each career had to go through and what each person went through during the pandemic. This is one of our shorter posts that we have for Sydney Bradshaw. It says, Sydney Bradshaw is a rapid response nurse. She has been a nurse for 4 years and works for Maxim Healthcare. She works in hotels with homeless COVID patients. This is a scary experience for Sydney for many reasons. She goes into rooms alone where there is sexual activity, drug use, and individuals who are COVID positive without any safety measures other than a walkie-talkie. She's able to prevent unnecessary deaths and treat superficial injuries that these people would not be able to treat on their own. She thinks that she is a better nurse after being exposed to so many different types of people than before. Sydney was mandated to do this job and is happy to help even though she's often mistreated by her patients and often feels unsafe. Thank you for your hard work and your perseverance, Sydney. Remember to thank all essential workers.
Once we had all our information gathered, our interviews conducted, and our write-ups posted to our page, we began the last step of our process. We set up a donation box at the front of the entrance of the school, which collected dried food, canned goods, and toiletries. We then printed out flyers and posters that we hung up around the school in the town of Freeport. They promoted our Instagram page and ways to donate to COVID relief centers. Once the donation box had been at the school for about a week, we brought it to the community center where we donated all the goods collected. This was the most rewarding part of our project because we were able to give back to our community.
Throughout our project, we encountered a wide variety of problems. The most significant one, having to quarantine the first week of the project when Eli got COVID. But we were able to overcome this hurdle by meeting virtually when Eli felt okay enough to work on the project. Another problem we encountered was having to do most of our interviews virtually. This wasn't a horrible setback, but it made the interview process less personal. Next is our successes. In interviewing a large array of different occupations, we were able to learn a lot about how each profession works. For example, I didn't know the different ways psychotherapists analyze patients' emotions during a session through posture, eye contact, and facial expressions. We also got to learn about how COVID has specifically affected these professions. It gave us more gratitude towards essential workers as we got to see the effects of COVID from a different perspective than our own.
We were able to acquire personal skills throughout the majority of this project. We got to conduct interviews, which is a firsthand, which is a vital life skill that we can apply to our future careers. We also learned more about conducting research that was specific to corresponding professions that we were interviewing for. Another personal skill we gained was promoting a social media page. This is a vital skill because it has to do with how to market something that you're trying to spread awareness about, which can be used in many career paths. When choosing how to promote our information, we considered who our information would be aimed towards. We then decided on an Instagram page because we wanted to reach a younger audience as they are the people who hold a big part of keeping other people safe during the pandemic. This project also taught us time management because we had a 4-week planning period and we knew what we had to get done and we had to stick to our schedule.
Classes we took throughout our time at Freeport High School significantly helped us with this project. The first class that helped us was public speaking. Not only did this class help us with the presentation aspect, which we're doing right now, it helped us with the interview process. Sometimes interviews would go a different way than expected, and we had to be able to quickly adapt and come up with new questions to ask our interviewee, which is a skill we had from Ms. Blyer's public speaking class. Another class that significantly helped us with the project was AP Lang. This class helped us with the research aspect of this project, because in the class we conducted specific research, which was a direct reflection of what we did in the project. Lastly, we got skills we needed from the art classes we took throughout our 4 years at high school. Specifically, 2D design helped us in designing the posters because in the class, we would use logo formatting and learn how to catch someone's eye when creating a flyer that had a marketing purpose. It also helped us in designing a more aesthetic theme to our Instagram page and slideshow.
We had a few community givebacks in our project. One was informing our community on what essential workers have to experience every day through this pandemic and what they have sacrificed to keep us safe. Another was informing people about COVID relief methods and how they can help the people in their community who are in need. We also promoted an Instagram page to spread awareness and show appreciation for all essential workers. And lastly, we donated what we could from our own homes as well as what we received in the donation box to help the people in our community who needed it.
Looking back at our project, we feel that we made a good impact on our community. When the project was first introduced to us, we had a choice of doing a project that was academic, had a community give back, or a social justice impact. We feel that with our project, we've done all three. We had a social justice impact by spreading awareness about what our frontline workers have gone through and made it clear that what they went through was real and not to be undermined by anybody. We had an academic aspect to our project because we learned about the different professions and more about the pandemic. Lastly, we had a community give back aspect because we showed appreciation for the strong frontline workers in our community and helped to donate to the families in our community who have been significantly impacted by the virus.
And we have some people we want to say thank you to. We want to say thank you to Mrs. Levitt and Mrs. Peterson for organizing this. Thank you to our project advisor, Mrs. Drolet and Mrs. Purcell. Thank you, Freeport High School, for this opportunity. And thank you, Officer Weed, Dr. Wozarski, Jennifer Mao, Mrs. Arsenal, Elena Wagner, Mrs. Zakow, Dr. Tim Fox, Mrs. Gulko, Wendy Lewis, Carlton Lewis, Harrison Bowen, Melissa Hager, Sydney Bradshaw, Dr. Sheep, and Dr. Christensen. And especially, thank you, essential workers.
Is there any questions?
Mrs. Peterson?
I know you gave us the clip into the woman that was a nurse working at the dump. In addition to that, what was another interview that stood out to you?
I interviewed somebody that is in medical school and is also a spine research fellow, and they had over 50% of their funding cut. So they haven't been able to have any clinical experience coming up the chain in medical school. So she's a fourth year med student that took a year to take her PhD off. So she didn't get any clinical experience this year. So it cut down on her rotations for maybe surgery or family medicine or whatever she had to go through. They had most of that experience taken away from them this year.
Mrs. Taylor.
Hopefully people will keep looking at it. We weren't going to add more to it, but we have information that will still be useful to everybody. Like, we have places where you can donate anything, where you can give blood, or, you know, places in our community, like the Freeport Community Center, where you can donate non-perishable food items or clothing. So that information will still be useful. And I feel like it's also kind of a time capsule. Like, you know, we can look back on this and see what experiences frontline workers went through back when the pandemic happened.
Ms. Blyer.
Did you see any, I love the cast of interviews that you selected. Did you see any stories from one of the frontline workers or another one that sort of silver lining, sort of the flip side of a positive, inspiring story?
Yes. So, actually, in all our interviews, we asked our interviewees if they had any silver linings to the pandemic. And one that stood out to me was Ellen Golding. She's the director of the maternity unit at Midcoast Hospital. And she said that because they were trying to reduce the amount of people that were in the hospital, the moms and the new babies would actually not go into the hospital as much. So the moms got to spend more time with their newborns than they would have if the pandemic wasn't happening. Thank you.
All right.
Thank you. Thank you.
Let's get it.